No, the Rancor.
Hello.
I've got to work on the ending of that, because using it here on StreamYard, there is no way to just click a button and it transitions. It just stops. So I've got to work on that. So welcome everyone to the Ranker Pit tonight. My name is Jason Hunt. I'm the editor here at Sci-Fi for Me. And with us tonight, the usual crew, Mrs. Boss, Mindy is here with us.
Hello.
As well as McKenna Tally, the host of
Scrums,
and our special guest, Shauna Terpsic.
She can't hear you.
Can't hear us. That's interesting. Why can't she hear us? Okay, so everything should be working. So
I can't hear anything.
Huh. All of a sudden she can't hear. That's very strange. Okay.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes. Yes, we can hear you.
That's not good. You're vibrating on that mic. I can't hear anything. I can hear the girls.
Interesting. Okay.
Should I leave and come back?
I don't know yet. Hang on just a second here. Let's pull you out and then pull you back in. Let's see if that does anything. Does that help? No? That's very strange. Can you ask her what she's hearing?
What are you hearing?
She says she's hearing the two of you. So, Mac, you want to ask her?
Can you hear me, Shauna? Can you hear me?
No. Everybody's really vibrating. Should I just leave and come back?
Yeah, let's try that. That's very strange. I don't know why that would be doing that, because she heard us just fine before we went on the air. So, anyway, hopefully this works. We are here. Yes, that is Shauna Terpsic. She is the costume designer for season 2 of The Mandalorian. And hopefully, nope, is she not going to be able to hear us?
Oh, there we go.
Oh, there it is.
Yay.
Just have to angle the iPad just right.
Yes.
And position your head just so. Yeah. Okay.
Get the kids off the Wi-Fi.
That'll yeah. All right. So welcome, Shauna. Thanks very much for joining us tonight. We're happy to have you. We're looking forward to just really, you know, twisting your arm and you know, putting the thumb screws and getting all sorts of information and answers out of you, right?
Yep, threatening with the Rancor Pit if I don't behave. Yeah.
So let's start with how you got started on the show. You're costume designer for season 2.
Yeah.
How'd you get involved? Because I see a lot of Joss Whedon programs. You've got a lot of geek cred in your resume.
Yeah.
How'd you land on The Mandalorian?
Well, I had met a lawyer, actually, who was a fan of Fireflies about 15 years ago, and she worked at Skywalker Ranch, and she brought me over there, gave me a tour. I met George Lucas. I saw a bunch of the stuff that they were working on, and then I didn't hear from them for 15 years, and then I got a text that said, are you working, or are you available, and are you interested in Star Wars? And I said, yes and yes, and they set up an interview with me to meet John and Dave and Colin Wilson, the producer. The designer from season 1 had moved on to a different show. And so I got the opportunity to interview with the producer, Colin, and he liked me. And he said, well, you need to meet with John, but he's on tour for Lion King. So I was on the phone with Joss Whedon, and I said, hey, I have this interview coming up. You know John Favreau, right? Because they had done Avengers together. He's like, yes. And I said, well, could you maybe email him a letter of recommendation, and then Josh said done. And I said, oh, great. Let me know if you heard back from him. He says, I did. He said, you're in. So then I got the interview. So that was pretty great. And that was all history now.
My apologies. Junior office dog over here is working the squeaky octopus. And just hang on for just a moment. Let us add Sam Sentiment to the stream. So hello, Sam. Welcome, sir.
How's everybody doing?
Now everybody's here. So
hey, Sam.
Okay, so Mac, you've got a question for Sean.
Oh, you went away.
Oh,
I'm with the dog. Just so.
The microphone is vibrating again.
Uh-oh.
Your sound is really good. I can hear you perfectly.
Okay.
His started vibrating again.
I have a question. Did John and Dave allow you to sneak any flamingos into the costumes? Oh.
You're vibrating. It's like that. I can't hear you.
Is this better?
No.
That's weird. Why does that keep doing that?
I can hear yours perfectly.
You can hear mine? Okay.
The Baby Yoda.
Okay, mine.
Yes. Grogu's. I can hear Grogu's mic perfectly.
Gremlins in the mix, folks.
Okay, Mindy, ask her if she was allowed to put flamingos on any of the costumes.
McKenna would like to know if you were allowed to put any flamingos on the costumes.
I did.
Which
and
one?
Of course, I did it in Jabba the Hutt in Bib Fortuna. Oh, spoilers. on a character that was in the background, and she never turned around. So I did a Star Wars version of a pink flamingo. Worked it into the artwork of her costume in the back, but she never turned around, so it never made camera.
So let me ask you this. I don't know. Can you?
You're gonna have to interpret, Melinda. I can't hear him.
Okay, so Mindy, I guess you're our interpreter tonight. That's
maybe
very
move your mic a little bit, maybe, because last time you did that, it worked.
One, two, one, two, no. One, two. No. Okay.
Sorry, I can't hear it.
Let me try this because it switched after. Sam, I'm going to pull you out for just a second. Let's see what that does because it looks like we flipped when that does that there make things.
I can hear you now.
Okay, so it's Sam's fault.
Bye, Sam.
Let me do this. Let me bring Sam back in and mute him. Let's see what that does. Okay, so that takes everything out. Or
nope,
is
I can
it,
hear you now.
You can hear us now. Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
When I unmute Sam. Now, can you hear us okay?
Yes. Very good.
All right. So, Mac, let's try you and see if Shauna can hear everybody. So, let's just kind of go around the room.
Hello? 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 Can you hear me now?
I hear a voice, yes.
All right. That's me.
Okay, great.
Oh, you know, the wonders of modern technology. What was it? What was it Scotty said in Star Trek 3? The more they overthink the plumbing, the easier it is to stop up the drain. It's just one little thing.
Yes.
So let me ask you this, Shauna, because you mentioned talking to Colin, and you said Colin is the producer. And, of course, we all know that Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni are on this thing.
Yes.
And not to stir the pot, but there are... rumors swirling about questions and speculations about how involved Kathleen Kennedy is with the show, actually. Her name's on it. She's an executive producer. She's president of Lucasfilm. But there are some people that think she doesn't have anything to do with it. There are some people that think she's got everything to do with it. Her hands are all over it. So from the inside, without getting yourself in trouble, how involved is Kathleen Kennedy in the production of The Mandalorian at this point?
So my question to you would be, what does it matter and who cares? But also, she was there quite a bit.
Okay.
She was on set. We had conversations. She's an amazing woman. But I'm not sure why the controversy.
Well, I think some of it stems from a number of people that have not been satisfied with the direction that the sequels went.
I don't think that was her decision. I think that I'm not behind the scenes.
Sure.
That far behind. I'm not in the power structure. I'm not a producer. So I couldn't tell you how many conversations are happening on phones. I do know that she is an incredibly gifted woman, and she was on set quite a bit, and she was always having long conversations and seemed incredibly friendly. and incredibly knowledgeable. We did talk one-on-one, and I felt very supported by her.
All right. Well, that's that gives us a little bit better of an understanding of the dynamics on set, because, you know, rumors swirl about and everybody's got their insiders and somebody's telling me this. And we have a source telling us this and, you know, that kind of thing. So I think that some would like to see her less involved. Some would like to see her more involved. So, you know, there's always that question that you know, when you get an opportunity to ask it, we throw that out there. So the costume design, for those who are not familiar with the process of the, you know, film and TV production, Mrs. Boss and I were talking about this earlier. If you could, for the layman in the audience, just kind of go through a little bit about what the costume designer is responsible for, because you're a department head, so you've got a number of different hats that you wear in shaping all of this.
Yes.
So what exactly does a costume designer do, especially now that you're on a science fiction show? You've got another layer of what you have to create, because you can't just go down to JCPenney and pick up
Well, I think that's a great question, because a lot of people don't know what I do. A lot of people think I sit in, you know, a pretty little office and draw pictures, and somehow they make it in front of the screen. As the costume designer, I design every single costume on every single character, main and background, that you see on camera. And that includes sketching, and I have a sketch artist. That includes hiring a team with, I have a woman that I hire to be my costume supervisor, that's Julie Robar, who works with me to help hire the crew to get everything done. So we have tailors, we have custom made builders, we have agers and dyers, we have the armor builders, we have fabricators who, and outside vendors like Legacy and Ironhead. We have a huge group, and then we have our set costumers that run everything. So I'm in charge of all of them. I'm in charge of every single person. So I'm a psychologist. I am a CEO that is running a multi-million dollar company. I'm in charge of every fabric that is purchased. I'm in charge of every accessory, every shoe that is built, of every item that goes through our workroom, and in charge of all the fittings. And I have a crew that is obviously helping me with the fittings, because there's hundreds and hundreds of them. And I go to every meeting with John and Dave and sometimes Doug Chang to create the unique looks for all these characters. Doug Chang at Lucas is doing a lot of art for production design and for props and for costume sort of ideas. And so those are for a few of the characters that we then interpret and build specialty for our show. But mostly it's on us to design everything.
Go ahead, Meg.
When you were designing the costumes, other than obviously using Star Wars as inspiration, did you have any other sources that you pulled from to create these costumes?
Yeah, I mean, so especially with The Mandalorian, we're tapping into the original resources and research that George Lucas did. So we're watching Seven Samurai, we're watching all these samurai movies, we're also watching The Good and the Bad and the Ugly and other Sergio Leone westerns, where characters wore sort of one costume for the entire life of the film, and yet you didn't seem to mind that they didn't change their clothes every 5 minutes. You know, we're establishing iconic characters that through their costume and, you know, obviously their performance, they're telling a story. And through the aging and the wear of the costume, they're telling a story. So besides noir films, I was given access to all of George Lucas's original files of research. They're all in this big world of Lucasfilm, and you can just scan through tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of photos from all the original art, all the original drawings, all the original influences. So I tried to do all my research exactly the way they did in 1977 and 1981, because those are the two films that we follow. And so I wanted to make sure that I was staying within that time period. So, you know, say I needed a panel on something, I wouldn't use an iPad for inspiration. I would use a Game Boy for inspiration, because that would have been what's available in 1981 or something. So it's, again, also just tapping into the technology that was available. I'm not using a lot of 3D printing fabrics, although we are using, you know, 3D printers, but I try to use it in a way that looks like we could have done it through sculpting and molding the technologies that were available back then.
That's really cool.
Yeah, I love it.
It makes it, I mean, you really feel like, especially, it's not just the, you know, animatronics and the puppets, and it's like the scenery and the costumes, everything plays into making you feel like you are truly in Star Wars.
And subconscious. They're definitely hitting your subconscious. John did something last season that made so much sense. I think Bryce even talked about it in the making of, where she wanted to do a crane shot. And he's like, that technology wouldn't have been available, except, especially if you're truly at sea. So they put the camera on sticks on the deck of the ship, and sort of your subconscious feels like a more of a period film because you're not using modern technology to capture the shot.
That's cool. That's super cool.
Let me circle back to the aging and weathering part of this. There's a couple of things that brings to mind. First of all, how much distress we saw on the Boba Fett armor at the beginning when Cobb Vanth had it. And then the paint job, that seems to have gotten a lot of response online. Some people think that it's okay, that's fine. Some people think, well, when did he have time to do it? And it kind of, you know, for some people, it kind of not really necessarily ruins it so much, but maybe takes away some of the character that the costume has by, you know, the matte finish and all of the new paint and everything. What was the discussions like as far as deciding what it was going to look like at the beginning and then changing it to the new look?
Well, he had been through the Sarlacc pit. We did a lot of tests to figure out what, you know, a stomach acid version would have done to the paint job on top of the Beskar. Obviously, it would hurt the Beskar, but we wanted to. We did different experiences and different research on what acid burning through, you know, metal paint would be. Then once we came happy with that technique for Cobb Vanth, having, you know, gotten it through, you know, various trials, I felt, and this was my argument, that I felt that Boba Fett would, and I brought the argument to John and Dave and said to me, like a samurai who respects and treats his armor well, he wouldn't leave it. And also it was his father's, it's traditional, it's a family heirloom, that he wouldn't leave it pitted and acid eaten. He would have refurbished it in a way. And, you know, having been on a quest to retrieve his armor, he would have had the paints available in the colors that he would want on a ship. So it would have been an easy and quick job, and almost a religious act to bring it back to its original glory. And that's why we decided to do that. That was my argument.
I like it. And I could live with that.
Well, and there are certain differences because with the, not necessarily, I mean, the cape is gone, but you've got the, not, what would you call what's hanging around his, it's not a robe, but there are pieces of this current costume that were not part of the original. What was the thought in changing the design, you know, and updating it for the show?
Well, I actually fought, you know, a little hard to get him in the black. So Dave Filoni was very concerned when I first proposed that he be in black, because he didn't want him to go evil or Darth Vader-y or anything like that, or Imperial. But my argument was to take it and age it and tatter it like an Omar Sharif or like a Mad Max, a wanderer in the desert who has survived and clawed his way out and crossed a far desert. And so if you look at the black costume of Omar Sharif, or you look at Mad Max, he had kind of the skirt, the layers, things that he had gathered from the desert floor and from his long travels through the desert, added to his costume in bits and pieces. And to me, you know, a skirt on a pant is something that you can put foods in and everything and help and tuck it back into your belt, and that would help you carry. So everything that I built on him is utilitarian, and everything is for a reason, and it tells a story. And it's also to help feed that romantic man standing on a desert dune in the in his costume blowing in the wind. If it was just all tight to him, like the original jumpsuit from ROTJ, it doesn't have that romanticism. It doesn't have that that long journey of a samurai, you know, crossing over many years and much wisdom, you know, to be gathered and sort of resonate so well in his costume. And so that's sort of the journey that I took to when why I drew it that way.
You're hang on, you're muted. Let me. No, you try to unmute yourself because you're.
Can I ask a question while you're figuring that out?
Go ahead.
So talking about the Beskar, like, what is, since going back to the technology that you used for the costume designs, what did you use for the Din Djarin's Beskar for his armor?
That was designed and made season one. So that was made by Legacy Effects, and all that research and the choices and the materials were all decided upon before I started.
Okay. What I was going to ask is, as you're going through and you're describing how you pictured Boba looking after spending all this time and not, you know, going from the jumpsuit to something that's more utilitarian. And what sits in the back of my head, I'm a huge Project Runway fan. So Tim Gunn always saying, push it, you know, how can you take this farther? But I also know there's a point where if you go too far, it just is ridiculous. And there's that fine balance that needs to happen. And for you, you know, fighting for what you want to see, how you picture it, what is it with when you're doing this? Because my Lord, you're in a whole nother world of everything. So your mind is swimming everywhere. Where is it for you when you're working on these projects? Where does that line where you've pushed it, but you don't want to go ridiculous?
I've been a Star Wars fan since 1977. I love the characters. I love the costumes of the characters. I fell in love with Luke Skywalker and Han Solo. So what I always remember about them is their iconic look. Again, I go back to that word because it's a simple, it doesn't pull from the character, but it adds to their character. And I think having just immersed myself in that world, and I'm designing in that world, I'm surrounded by images. That's all I'm looking at. That's all I'm reading. That's all I'm studying. That dog just ran by. I just allow myself to design from my heart and design from my passion and let the character speak to me and let the words on the page that are written by John speak to me. And then I literally I'm offering one sketch. By the time I show the boys the sketch, it's one sketch. I've put together sort of walls of research and fed off of them what they're responding to, what they're saying, less of this, more of that. And then I'm doing one sketch and it gets approved and I move forward. So I have to move very quickly. We shoot an episode every 10 days and it has to be film quality. And so while we're filming those 10 days, we're also shooting two units. So two different episodes at the same time with two film directors on each episode. And we're prepping those 10 days for the next episode and for the next series. So I don't have a lot of time to second guess myself. So I have to be completely in the world and trust my instincts and trust the guidance of John and Dave that I'm going to get it right and that they're going to protect me from ever overstepping. And again, Doug Chang, who's been a part of every single Star Wars, you know, franchise film is it protects me as well. I bounce ideas off of them before I do the final sketch.
So you were saying that you're in charge of every single piece of everything that shows up on that camera, yeah. basically. So, and you have just a 10-day period, or like how far in advance did they allow you to start reading the material, to start working on your sketches and stuff?
Well, in season two, I guess there were some rewrites and things. We were getting the script, the whole script, sometimes 10 days before we were shooting. So you're 10 days, you know, some of the bigger characters, they would say, this character's coming down the line, because, you know, a costume like Boba Fett's or Din Djarin's, or, you know, they're going to take at least a month or two to build.
Uh-huh.
Usually they take 4 or 5 months, but we don't always get that. And there's usually a camera test a few weeks before we actually shoot. So, you know, you know, 4 to 6 weeks max, but never that long.
Wow.
I mean, I've literally done a fitting and built a costume and put the guy on camera the next morning.
That's insane. That's a lot.
Yeah, sometimes you have a day.
Well, if you're getting your, you know, possibly the script 10 days, you know, like that close in time, then let me ask you this, because it was something that Mr. Boss and I were talking about. Mr. Boss and I were talking about earlier, that with the final scene at the end of the season with Luke showing up. I mean,
spoilers,
everybody. But no, I mean, when you're sitting there and you get the script finally, you know, and I don't know how much of a surprise, you know, I mean, obviously you're having to design everything, but I mean, in your mind, I mean, how much time did they give you for that? And what was going through your mind at that moment?
So this is very funny. He was very top secret. So all I was told was a Jedi character in all black and measurements. That's all I was given. So then I had to sort of reverse engineer it. I'm like, you guys, I'm making the costume, so I kind of need a little more information. Is it this guy? And they're like, I cannot, you know, confirm or deny. So we built it for that guy. We built, if I can say it, we built it for, you know, for Mark Hamill. And they said, we also need you to build it for Mark Hamill's size that he would have been in 1977. So we built it for Mark Hamill himself, because he was there playing the character. And we also built it for his stunt double, which was his actual size he would have been in 1977. And they never said his name, honestly. They never said his name. We just got, this is the person's measurements who you're building a costume for. And I said, okay, am I getting this person a black glove for a certain?
Or was that a sequence like Michael Jackson?
You had to incorporate
that. That's a really good point. Yes, you are going to be. You are going to need a black glove
and the belt buckle.
Yeah, no, everything. But it was literally me picking information out. Like, and I'm like, you guys, I'm not going to tell anybody. I've signed my life away. I can't, you know, just let me know. And so we didn't get a fitting with Mark until the day he worked. And it was a closed set. I was only allowed to tell one of my crew to come help me. And so obviously there was no corrections that we could have made. He was given the costume over the holiday to practice fighting, and, you know, to make sure that he could move in what I had built him. But I wasn't part of that fitting. It was just Peyton and John who went and visited him. And I asked him when they got back, am I, did everything fit? You know, and they said, yes, it was perfect. And he loved it. And then I got to sit in his dressing room and chat with him and, you know, try not to misstep in fangirl love. I mean, he's a magnificent man. He's incredibly intelligent. And just so down to earth, and just one of us. He's a fan of the show, and he's a fan of his fans. And he was so blessed to bring this to the screen. And it was him. I even showed him how to remove the hood. I said, come up from, because he's like, how did you build this? You know, how will I affect it? And I said, well, we've put a little netting under the hood so it holds its weight. So if you pull it from under here, it'll fall really beautifully. You know, so we. And he did it just like that. And it was beautiful. It was a beautiful moment.
So Mark.
So
Mark
we had a couple of weeks to build it, and I never got a fitting.
So Mark filmed all of the hallway fight as well. In addition,
no, that was
to the bridge.
His stunt double. He was all the bridge, all the dialogue was him.
Okay.
All right. And he did some of the movements, but it was everything on the bridge is him.
So Sci-Fi Snob in the chat asks, what costume has taken the longest for you to build on the show?
Boba Fett, for sure. Because not only building it, but it was getting the fittings and getting approvals and making sure everybody liked the aging levels and the dye levels and the paint jobs. And so his took probably the longest. I feel like Ahsoka was probably quite long too. Because I had the panels quilted and then aged and then embroidered with the same markings from the animation, and then I had my specialty maker hand carve the circle piece. It has writing on both sides, and I collected every single bead that's on the bead trim on her belt. And my leather guy worked tirelessly getting the leather just right on her obi. And then we had three or four fittings with Rosario, because we got Rosario the day before she worked too. So we had to actually do fittings while she was working, because we didn't have time before. So she would work a day, and then we would sew all night, and then she would work a day, and then we would sew all night, and then we finally got it all right. So hers probably took the longest.
And what was it like to be a part of helping bring Ahsoka Tano to live action? Like, that had to be pretty cool.
It was, I mean, I still get chills. I still get chills, quite honestly. I was there when we filmed everything, and I still tear up and get chills. And it was beautiful. She is her. She completely embodied her. She had that energy, that youthful energy that we all knew from all the animation, from her being very young to growing up. She embodied every aspect of that maturity level. And to watch that come to life was beautiful. And what was great too was just watching Dave, you know, watching Dave Filoni watch his creation just bounce around on stage and be a true living being, you know. Pinocchio came alive.
Well, I do have to say that, you know, coming into seeing her play, you know, in real life versus what we've seen in the animation. And yeah, she has grown up. I mean, she was this thing at the very beginning of Clone Wars that I did not like, but grew to fall in love with and watch her grow up. And the one thing I absolutely loved about the costume was that it, coming from a girl's point of view who goes through puberty and all that, you could see the woman. She wasn't the kid. She wasn't the tomboyish, you know, whatever you want to say, you know, that we saw in Rebels and stuff to that effect. But seeing her, seeing the woman figure underneath the clothing, it's just like, she's one of us. I mean, all of a sudden you're able to identify, like, oh, she's had to go through those growing pains probably too. So that I think was beautifully done.
I tried very hard to do that with Bo-Katan as well. And even Gina Cara Dune's costume. I brought it down so you could see her bust, and I brought it in and I quartzed her a little bit more, because part of the power to me of our femininity is never hiding it. And you can be a very powerful warrior and be 100% female and 100% badass. And I didn't want to flatten Bo-Katan. I didn't want to hide Ahsoka, and I didn't want to flatten Gina's character. And so I was very supported in my promoting their femininity by John. He's an incredible advocate for feminine.
Well, and Gina being, you know, having her history with what she's done and her body being so muscular, you weren't, and you know, for me, you know, I'm sitting there looking at her, and yeah, she's got a great body and everything, but the muscles in her legs and her hips and her back end and everything, you aren't afraid to show it. I mean, it's not the perfect stick figure that you may see walking down, you know, wherever. She's full woman, but she's full muscle and will kick your butt.
Yeah.
And you show every aspect.
Yeah, she's a girly girl, surprisingly. I mean, she's just gorgeous, like Jane Russell, like a tough broad. I just love her.
Now, Shauna, let me ask you this, because you mentioned the Bo-Katan's costume, and there was some online back and forth, and I know this. I'm the one to get to ask the controversial questions, I guess. The idea,
I can take
the complaints about the curves in the armor, you know, and there was this whole thing. I think it was probably a good 3 days worth of back and forth on Twitter about armor for women as opposed to armor for men, and it all should look the same, and you're sexualizing them, and how dare you do this and everything. How much conversation takes place on set or behind the scenes? How much are the production people paying attention to what's being said online? Does that ever get talked about? You guys go through and say, did you see what they post on Twitter? What's all this? Is that ever a thing?
That all comes out after.
Yeah.
I've already done my job, and I've already validated my choices. If you look at female armor back to medieval ages, they had boobs, and it's not sexualizing a woman to have boobs. Women have boobs, guys, and we're a different sex than you, and our boobs stick out. And
thank you.
And if somebody feels that you're sexualizing a woman by giving her boobs, that's silly, because girls have boobs. So I respect everybody's opinion, but I think that that's a very silly argument to say that if you're allowing for women's breasts in armor, that you're sexualizing them. If I show cleavage, I am not sexualizing a woman. I am allowing her femininity to be shown in all of its beauty. That's like saying, honestly, this is a bit harsh, but saying for a man to say that the reason why a woman got raped was because she was wearing a miniskirt. That's ridiculous. We're allowed to show our bodies without being sexualized. If somebody's sexualizing them, then that's you from your point of view. You know, I am not sexualizing a woman by celebrating her femininity. Right. And if you're wearing tight armor that's supposed to protect you, just like a man wears a cod piece to cover his soft bits, a woman is going to wear a breastplate to cover her soft bits. And I believe very much in staying loyal to reality. And it would be very unrealistic for me to flatten their boobs. And I stand very strong. When those two women, Bo-Katan and Kosuka, walked on set, everyone was like, oh my gosh, they look so powerful. And you know what? You could see every curve of their body. And that was because they're wearing jumpsuits. And when you're wearing jumpsuits, you don't want to let a lot of extra fabric to get in your way. These girls are warriors. I mean, Sasha Banks is a real wrestler. Like, she'll fly from a 6 foot tall rope and kill you. And, you know, she was able to do all of her movement in that jumpsuit. So I created authentic armor and jumpsuits so that these women can fight and be fully feminine and fully warrior. And I stand by that.
And I will say, I mean, that in the show came off very strong, especially in the scene where you've got Bo-Katan and Fennec and I'm sorry, Cara Dune, and they're just,
wasn't that marvelous? That was so powerful. Yes, and so beautiful. And every single one of them was showing off their feminine figure.
Oh, they're women, but they're also like badasses, you know, they're kicking ass, and it's just them. You know,
and working so well as a team, and not bickering, and not having to throw out silly comedic lines. They were authentically strong and powerful team that works together, as most women do. And on John's set, all the women work together. And our first AD is a very powerful woman. There's very powerful women producers that are working with us, Karen Gilchrist and Kathleen Kennedy and others. And you know, we support each other and we work together. And too often in film, women are masculinized if they're tough, or they're bickery and gossipy, and silly instead of very intelligent, strong women. And that's on John's shows, we get to project, you know.
Well, and I'm thinking here, you're talking about, you know, being able to show the femininity, and with Ming Wang, Ming-Na Wen's hair through this season. I mean, she's got it done up, and but then you have that red lacing that is going through,
Maria.
Which must have taken for
design that.
And you look at that and you think about back in the more medieval times where the women had it up and they had those around, you know, the, I don't know what they're actually called, but the nettings around to hold their, and it was like almost
like a snood, almost.
And so you have the same thing going on where the hair's back because you don't want it in your face when you're trying to do stuff, but it's done in such a way that it's not just like, you know, tight net bun, whatever. But then you just have that delicate red against her hair being that dark, and it just stands out. And same with Sasha Banks and her hair, you know, she takes it off and she's got that braid. Through here, which I'm not quite a fan of, but at the same time,
it's
interesting to look at. It was just more of like, I really want to move that out of the way somewhere.
that's Maria, the hair designer, and she's amazing. I love what she does with the ladies.
I'm going to let you.
Sam's got enough hair on his beard that we could sit there and try some of this out.
We could braid his beard.
Wouldn't be the first time.
Now in the chat, Sci-Fi Snob, he would like to know how much can Mando and Fett actually see through their helmets? And I understand because it's like this tiny little
That's
thing.
A really good question. So we actually this season, season two, I did a 3D scan, you know, of Boba Fett. We're trying to get the helmets closer because when they're closer, they do have more peripheral and below vision, but it is difficult. And it's our thought to, again, perfect that. They're not quite perfect yet. So it is limited. It's definitely limited. And with some of the bigger stunts and running down rocks and everything, it was getting dangerous. So we're going to rework that a bit.
So with Mando's costume is all original. How much, if any, of the Boba Fett costume is original pieces from the original trilogy? Is there any part of the original Boba Fett costume that's on set right now?
No, that's all at Skywalker Ranch.
Okay. All right, that's all in the archive.
And so Mandalorians is original. Oh, I see what you're saying.
Yeah,
Mandalorians is original to our show. Mm-hmm. You're asking if I had any of ROTJ's costume? Right.
Yeah,
no.
if there's any of the original Boba Fett costume that Jeremy Bullock wore that you guys, but you're saying you scan the helmet. So you're basically taking the one that's in the museum piece essentially, and you're using that as the template for the build on the new stuff.
Right. We didn't scan anything. I did it the old fashioned way. I went up there with my cell phone and a color card and I took a million pictures and we matched and, you know, measured, you know, how far the dent is from here and, you know, wherever scratches that we needed to duplicate. But yeah, Doug Chang flew me down to, or up to north, up north, up to San Francisco. And, I got to touch Tusken Raiders and Jawas and Boba Fett and R2-D2 just for the fun of it. you know, speeder bike racers and Imperial costumes, and look at the boots and measure the heel of the Imperial costume boots and, you know, source the right material. It was really, really important to me to be as authentically loyal to every stitch and every material that they used to get it right. But no, all that stuff's in archives at Skywalker Ranch.
Did you find yourself ever needing to consult with local cosplayers for any of this stuff? Because they do a lot of research to get their stuff screen accurate. And I remember Dave talking at Celebration, we were talking about, we don't have enough stormtroopers. And they called the local 501st. And
Dave
they
called
said,
them,
you know,
yeah.
These guys show up in costumes that look better than the ones that we built. Are you, Do you ever
that
have
was season
conversations?
One. Yeah, season well, two. That was season two.
But
season two, I did some new things to them. So,
do you lurk in the cosplay forums to see what other people are talking about as far as builds for any of these costumes type of things? You know, because other people are building these same costumes and have been for the last 10, 15, 20 years.
Longer, yeah.
Are you? Well, even before the show, did you ever have conversations and say, oh, well, you know, if I ever get to do a Star Wars show, this is what I'm going to do?
No. I've been going to Comic-Con, 10, 12 years, ever since, you know, Firefly. And and I have pictures of myself with every Boba Fett on the floor because I've always been, he's always been my favorite. And who knew that I'd be one day redesigning him, you know?
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Sorry, go ahead.
Every time there's a Boba Fett on the floor, I stop him and take pictures. But no, I didn't. I had to do my own research so that I wouldn't worry that I was copying anything but the real one. And so I did all my own research. Started from scratch.
I do have a couple of questions about as far as cosplay goes. So when you did Firefly, you had auctioned off some of your private collection. Mm-hmm. Do you have anything for Mandalorian?
No.
No?
Disney owns everything. Disney owns my very breath that I breathe. careful about all the proprietary stuff. Yeah.
Is there anything, any costume from season two in particular you are like, once it's safe for all of us to gather again at a con, that you're excited to see cosplayed like in person?
Oh my gosh, I'm so excited to see Ahsoka and Boba. I'm excited to see every single one of them, and it's my hope. And I've been talking with Doug Chang, you know, can we dress mannequins in all the originals? Because so many people are reaching out to me on Facebook and things and asking me so many questions on, you know, how far is the stitch from this and what is this made out of and how did you put this together? And my goodness, I would love to send you all of my fitting photos and all of my flats and all of my drawings and all of my measurements, but I don't own them, so I can't do any of that. All that's at Disney, and Disney owns all that. But it's my hope that maybe we can do an exhibit with all of the original costumes and then do a panel where I can say, this is what this fabric looked like when we bought it. This is the process that I like with Ahsoka's, because hers is a very shiny silk from China, her pants. And then I washed it and aged it and became almost like tissue, very gauzy. And it's, you would never know by looking at it what I started with. And so I would love to bring what I started with and how I got to where it is now so that I can help my cosplayers get as accurate as they want. And, you know, I love it when people just make up their own. I love that too. And I marvel at it, you know, ever since Jane's hat started walking around at Comic-Cons and I'm chasing them around. I was like, I designed that, you know, it's like, I'm a huge fan of the whole process. And Kaylee's, you know, layer cake dress, when I see people's interpretation on what they chose to build it out of. But back then I didn't know anything about it. So I never was keeping track in my head on how I made this and what this material was and what the aging process was. I just got the work done. But having that knowledge that there's going to be cosplays of these, I would love to put together an exhibit and have a panel and have you guys drill me and get all the information, because part of the joy of what I do is seeing people bring it to life with their own touch and in their own way. And it's the biggest gift of all. I just love it.
Well, even if we're not able to do anything in person yet, maybe we can set up a virtual panel at some point, because we've been talking about doing some virtual con type of things here. Maybe we can put together some cosplayers and some costume designers and we do this big get together and everybody can kibitz back and forth and trade secrets.
Yep.
Well, and I have a quick question on the cosplay. One of the things I've learned to love with going to these conventions, and when I'm interviewing people for one of the shows that we try to do, which is Cosplay Diaries, talking to people about what their first time with it and what they did and why they did it. But one of the things I absolutely love is when you have these mashups, and you have worked on a lot. And I mean, for you going to, if you were to walk into a convention, what, have you seen of like your work mashed up with something? What have you seen that you just were like, oh, wow, they really did that? And that's amazing.
It's always like, you know, working Captain Jack Hartness from Torchwood, you know, with Captain Mal Reynolds from Firefly. There was a mashup of those because I designed both those characters, and then of course they had like pink flamingo slippers on or something. They had it was like the Shauna costume. I've seen really creative, especially with like Kaylee and Jane and Wash. They would have like the Hawaiian shirt and the puffy skirt and the Jane hat. You know, they brought the whole Firefly crew together. But now I get to add Star Wars to that, you know. So I love Torchwood, Firefly, Star Wars, Dr. Horrible. You know, I have, so people can really have a lot of fun with it.
That's awesome.
Mm-hmm. And Cabin in the Woods, the bloody Chris Hemsworth, right?
Is there a Star Wars, is there a Star Wars character that you have on your wish list that you would love to do some costumes for X character you're not going to get a chance to, or maybe you'll get a chance to and you can't tell us?
I mean, Boba Fett was always my favorite, quite frankly. And I got to touch him, and I get to go down in history with that. And that's a pretty overwhelmingly beautiful thing. The second, of course, would have been Luke Skywalker, and I got to touch him as well. And I think all the new characters they're bringing to life are so powerful. I'm excited to become part of canon with that. And even with the stormtroopers, you know, we reduced the level of mixture for their armor so they have more movement. So suddenly it's canon now to have stormtroopers run and jump on rocks and not kill themselves. And also it's the first time in Star Wars history where we removed the cannon from the back. And that's never happened in any Star Wars movie. So I get to be a part of a lot of little historic moments, whether it be with a stormtrooper or Boba Fett. So I love every character, quite frankly. Anything that has to do with Star Wars, I'm just thrilled about. I won't be a part of the Obi-Wan, show, but I did get to meet Ewan, and that was a pretty amazing day, too. So.
Well, speaking of troopers and bringing things to life, Sci-Fi Snob was asking about the design with the dark troopers.
Yeah.
Because he was asking, robots, or are they all CGI?
Oh, no, they're costumes. There's people in them. And then CGI was mixed in. Those were built by Legacy Effects. And there's a guy in there. there's a few guys, and there's a couple guys in there. And if you watch the gallery for season 2, it explains who the guys were in there, and it shows the costumers putting their helmets on and putting them in there.
How much adjustment do you have to do for the stunts? Because there was a lot of talk about Ahsoka and her montrals not being long enough for the age that she was. Everybody was talking about they're too short. They're not long enough. She's older and she's a grown up and they should be down to her waist and stuff. And I understand that some of that was making allowances for the stunt work that she had to do. How much compromise goes into what ends up on camera for your department?
Well, that's hair and makeup. That was makeup. That wasn't me. So that was, I don't know how that conversation went down. And I don't know why those decisions were made. I'm sure everything that people are saying is probably right, but I actually don't know why that decision was made. So I'm just in charge of the neck down. I didn't design the makeup parts.
Do you have designs that get tossed a lot? I mean, I'm sure there's the pile that it's, no, we're not going to do this, we're not going to do that. I mean, are we ever going to see Cara Dune in anything other than the armor? I mean, we've seen Greef Karga in 2 or 3 different outfits now. Kara's probably got to have some kind of off-duty wardrobe. Are we going to see any kind of thing? Anything that's just still percolating that you're pushing for
Star Wars is all about having one costume. You know, if you look at, you know, a lot of the characters, they wore one look for the whole show. With the new shows, they are having more changes. You tend to see them go through different looks. I don't know. I mean, I did change Cara Dune's costume for this season, for season two. She got the Marshall belt. I lowered her top. I brought in the waist. I changed the armor at the center front. With Grief, obviously, I updated his costume. But once he was in that costume, that's what he wore every time you see him. And Cara Dune stays in hers. Din Djarin stays in his. I guess even Boba Fett had a little transition, obviously, in the paint job. But I don't know. I'm always open to, I just have to bounce off whatever they write.
All right. Now, the question of staying in costume.
Yeah.
I have to ask this question.
Oh my gosh, don't do this.
Nope, I got to.
Do it.
If I'm going to cover all the bases, because somebody's going to want to know.
I got to go to bed. I can't even.
There are reports.
No.
Credible or not, that there was a little bit of a situation on set with Pedro Pascal and the helmet. What can you say? What can you tell us? What actually happened there? Is this a lot of?
I don't know what story you're talking about, actually.
Well, we had heard that he was getting frustrated about the fact that he had to have the helmet on all the time.
Oh.
And had become difficult on set. And we're getting different reports, conflicting reports. Some people were saying there's actually something to it. Some people are saying there's nothing to it. So you've been there.
Yeah. No, he's an amazing actor and an incredible professional. And, you know, just enjoy the show.
There you go.
Just enjoy the show. I wouldn't get involved.
I knew it.
Out of denial.
No. I mean, obviously, every actor, like, you know, Boba Fett would probably want to be with the helmet off more, and Fennec would probably want to have. I mean, sure. They're actors; they want to act with their faces. But I think what's to all of their credit is that they could be just as emotional and just as dramatic, and you're not getting anything from the face. You're not getting raised eyebrows. You're not getting furrows. But they're communicating 100% emotion. And I think when I'm saying that he's an incredible professional, he's pulling off the character. In full helmet. And, you know, obviously we have stunt doubles and body doubles, you know, for different things, but so Brendan Wayne is also in the costume. Right. And so is Lateef Crowder. Pedro's on set and I never heard him whine to me, you know, oh, I want to take my helmet. He never said that. And when he did, oh my gosh, the performance level that the scene between him and, you know, when they were in that, when he took off his helmet in the Imperial, oh God, you know,
my husband bawled like a baby during that scene.
So incredibly beautiful. That whole story arc. So what I would suggest to everybody is not to give in to all that pettiness. It diminishes the beauty of the show. And if you love the show and love a performance, why try to dig up dirt on some weird rumor backstory? Just enjoy his magnificent performance and who he is. And he did. I mean, it's really tough being in all that armor, and it's really hot, and it is heavy, and it pokes at you, and it hurts. You know, probably after 12 hours, and I'm sure the helmet gets very hot. But he wore it, and he performed in it, and he did a beautiful, beautiful job. And it kind of breaks my heart that people are trying to tear any of that down. Actors work so hard.
I'm not sure that I'm getting a sense that anybody wants to tear it down so much. I think there's a lot of concern because The Mandalorian seems to be the one project that everybody seems to like.
Oh yeah.
And enjoy. And there's, you know, it's more, oh, we hope it doesn't get ruined by, you know, fill in the blank. I think there's
don't worry, kids, it's there. Not gonna get ruined. It's not gonna get ruined. No.
I think it's in pretty good hands.
At all. Not even a little bit.
So are there on screen hints between differences in the costumes between what Brendan wears and Lateef wears? Are there ways that we can tell who's on screen?
Oh, you're adorable. No. Lateef is the stunt man, And right. So, but Pedro was in it the majority of time. So,
yeah. Was he, there was a lot of talk that Pedro was actually on set more, or at least in the costume, more acting than the stunt doubles this season than he was in season one. And yes. I know you weren't on season one, but can you confirm that he was on set like a lot and in the costume a lot?
In season two, yes.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, if you watch the gallery, you'll see the behind the scenes. He was in every scene. Yeah.
And
Brendan Wayne. And you'll see when he walks on set with his cowboy hat, everybody's applauding him and thrilled that he's there too. It's definitely camaraderie and they're definitely working together. But no, Pedro was there like every scene. So.
And what are the plans for season three?
Hi, how are you? Good to see you.
I've got a question that's kind of non-costume question, but I would like to have the reaction. With being on set,
yes,
going into the vault, I mean, you've worked on a lot of stuff, so you've been on sets or in the field or whatever, but this is a whole new ball game. So what for you, the first time you walked on and were inside the vault, and I mean, you've heard about it and all this, but now you actually get to see it for yourself.
Yeah. It was overwhelming. It was surreal. I mean, literally, we were shooting that one scene with the Gamorreans fight, and John had to make an announcement that where he was standing was the only way in or out, that all the rest of the doors were just projections because it looked so real. So you're in it and it feels totally real. And then they can flip a switch and then you're in the desert. And then they flip a switch and you're in a junkyard. It's disconcerting because you the doors look real until you're this close from it. But like even a foot afar from it, it looks 100% real. So he had to make an announcement so nobody would walk into a wall.
Yeah, because those LED panels are not cheap.
Yeah.
I have a question, and I have to ask it because I love Grogu so much. Did you get to like hold him? And what was that like? And is he as adorable in real life?
he's adorable, and it's and just again when if you see the gallery with George Lucas holding him, or even when Pedro when Robert Rodriguez is playing the guitar and Grogu's responding, you forget that he's not real.
Yeah.
He's looking up at you and he's blinking and reacting, and if you're just looking at him and not at, the four guys in back controlling him, it's really cool. It's really really a special little animatronic.
He's so cute.
All right, so we're getting into our hour here. It's going to be pumpkin time here fairly soon for us. So one thing that I wanted to really quick to confirm whether or not are you working on the Book of Boba Fett, or you're just on the Mandalorian?
It's COVID. Everybody's home right now.
She did season two of Mandalorian.
That's what we can talk about. Yes.
Yes. He's got to try.
It's 30 years of media. I got to ask that one last question. So, all right. Well,
I can only talk about season two.
Okay. We've heard security on these shows is really, Mark Hamill even talked about the fact that Luke didn't, that whole thing didn't leak for a year.
Yeah.
Was just phenomenal. Everybody,
yeah, it's amazing.
Their own little piece of the script. Nobody gets everything. Does that ever hinder the process? I mean, you talk about having to figure out Luke's costume, but just
that was the only time that happened. Yeah.
Okay. So does that ever create a problem for you guys? You're not able to talk about things and you can't get something done. Does it slow things down at all?
No, not at all. Usually I get everything. that was a unique situation, and we figured it out. maybe that was part of the fun, was having me have to figure it out. But everything else is shared. I have to design everything from scratch anyways, and so it's not like I need to use outside vendors for very much. And the couple of outside vendors I do use to have to sign their life away, you know, and give Disney full access to, you know, to everything. So Disney can push delete at any time they want. It's never hindered me. I have a hard time keeping secrets, and so I just don't talk about it. My son, you know, doesn't want to know anything because he's a huge Star Wars fan. And so if I bring home a sketch, he'll like close my bedroom door. So, you know, that nothing to be seen what I'm even drawing. So we tend to be very, very good at keeping secrets. Just because as a fan, I want to be surprised. I don't want spoilers, and I don't want to spoil it for anybody else. And, you know, especially you see how much it touched Mark Hamill. If somebody were to take that from him, that would have broken my heart. Yeah. You know, and it blessed him as much as it blessed all of his fans. So I think that because we all love the show so much, we work very hard to keep the secrets.
All right. Well, we will let you keep your secrets tonight, but you're on. All right. Shauna Terpsich, thank you very much for joining.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Hopefully we can have you back again. And all of you in the chat, thanks very much for being here. If you are watching this in replay, you can always leave your comments through email, rancorpit@scififreaking.com. And we will be back to do this all again, what, in 2 weeks?
Yes.
2 weeks. All right.
2 weeks. So,
thanks, everybody. Good night. And
good night.
Good night.
All right.
Night. Thanks.